Welcome to Programming with Qt Widgets. In today's episode, we'll talk about the object model in Qt. If you ever played with Qt Designer, you might not entirely understand and grasp all the power that happens in the class QObject. That's what we'll resolve in today's episode. At the heart of the Qt object model, you'll find the class QObject. And if you've ever done any Java programming, you would know the class Object from Java, which is the superclass of anything in Java. And that is exactly what QObject is not. QObject is not about being superclass of anything in Qt. Actually, I'd guesstimate that 20-30% of the Qt classes has QObject as a superclass. But there's one very important subclass of QObject that we'll see a lot in this training, namely QWidget. And what is the responsibility of QObject? Well, let's see. First of all, the signal slot mechanism. That is how objects communicate with each other. We'll talk about that in a few videos. And that's the property system. And you've seen that already in the previous video where we talked about the help system. You saw the properties in there. Properties is how you can edit your widgets in the sidebar inside of Qt Designer. We'll talk about that in some videos ahead. Properties is a cornerstone for QML. If you've ever seen or smelled a bit at what that feels like, there's properties all over the place there. Properties is important for inter-process communication with, say, QRemote objects or DBus. So properties is super at the core of what Qt is all about. And then finally, if you've ever been in a discussion with a Java developer, he'll try and win the discussion over C++ by saying something like, well, Java is a better language than C++ because it has garbage collection. And that's where you know you won, because you'll counter that by saying, well, C++ is the better language than Java because it doesn't have garbage collection. But let's admit it, a lot of the bugs that you'll find in C++ application comes from memory leaks. And Qt has a solution to that. Not a solution that will solve all problems ever, but a solution that will help you in a lot of different places. And that is the object, or the parent-child relationship among objects. So a dialogue might have some children. These children are then parented with the dialogue. So the dialogue owns all the content directly or indirectly in the parent-child relationship. Some of these features, they are just fancy C++. So the parent-child relationship is just a matter of convention that anything inheriting QObject takes a QObject pointer parent as the last parameter. And then whenever you create a QObject subclass of that, then it will go to the parent and say, hey, I'm a child of you now. And the parent will make a small note in its notebook saying, okay, I got a child here. While other things, the signal slot mechanism most noticeable, and the property system for that matter also, that is done using a meta object compiler. And we'll talk about that in a few episodes. And if you already start getting goosebumps and don't worry, it is very non-intrusive. Lots and lots of material is available from KDAB on YouTube, but we also have blog posts where you can get a bit deeper into the topic as a blog post allows you. And let me just give you three examples from blog posts in QTopia. So most recently we have optimizing and sharing shader structures. That's a 3D topic. Intro to coroutines, C++, and reverse engineering Android apps. Follow the link to get to our blogs. It's easy to confuse the parent-child relationship with inheritance, especially when you're new to Qt, because there are inheritance where you have at the top, you have QWidget, being or QObject being the superclass of QWidget, which is the superclass of QPushButton, for example. And then you have a QWidget that is the parent of a QPushButton. So let's just dwell a bit into that. So the parent-child relationship is all about where, or all about memory management. And when we get to the widget level, which we'll do in the next episode, it's also about who is laying, who's, where are widget being laid out. So what you see over here on the screen is the parent-child relationship. One object here is the parent of a number of other objects. And as I hinted just before, the QObject constructor is given this QObject pointer parent equal to null pointer, so you can sometimes not do it, but you can specify the parent there. And if we're talking about widgets, then the parent-child relationship is somewhat hidden because of layout managers, but I'm ahead of myself. That is for the next video. And then you might ask yourself, okay, so how does destruction of all this work? Well, pretty simple. Whenever you go and kill a parent object, not in the real world, but kill a parent object, then it has a list of all its children. And it'll simply go through that list and call delete on each of the children. And if a child is deleted before the parent, it will simply, in its destructor, go to its parent and say, oh, by the way, I know that I told you I'm a child of you, but no longer am I around, so please take me out of your list. And that's how the parent-child relationship works. I'm just checking in with you here. Any goosebumps up there? Any small hair that's raised on the back? I said that the parent will run through the list of the children and call delete on them. Well, obviously, you should be super careful when you are mixing stuff allocated using new and stuff allocated on the stack. I learned Qt way before any training ever existed. I learned Qt before any books on Qt existed. So I basically learned it from looking at other people's source code. And I saw that there was stuff about new and Qt all over the place. So rather than just creating a Qt push button on the stack, I would allocate it using new. And that made a lot of sense, because just imagine that you created a main.cpp, just as we did a few videos ago. And in your main.cpp, you had your Qt push button on the stack. And then somebody came around and said, hey, you can actually create functions in C++, so how about setting up all the user interface in a function called initialize? And you say, hey, that's a great idea. You take your push button, you put it into an initialized function, and you call that from main.cpp. What will happen? Well, if you don't change anything but putting it in there, then as soon as that initialize function is done, the stacked object, your push button, will go out of scope and you'll never see it on the screen. Seems like a silly example, right? But when we talk about dialogues and modal dialogues in a few episodes from now, you will notice that that is a true situation where you can get in trouble like that. But I'm ahead of myself. What was I talking about? I was talking about what should be allocated using new and what shouldn't. And when I learned Qt, I taught myself a rhyme that helped me a lot. It says, anything that starts with a Q must be allocated using new. Cool, right? It's 25 years ago since I learned Qt, but the only thing about it is that it's not true. Not everything that starts with Q must be allocated using new. There are things, and that's what we have here on the screen. So if I have a Q label or any widgets, I very likely want to allocate them using new and give them a parent. Or the parent might be implicit in the layout manager, but that's for next video. But I have a number of things that are actually subclasses of QObject, but which I do often allocate on the stack. The first of them is your Q application. The one that we saw before, could have been QGUI application had this been a QML training, but just a Q application object that we created. That one will live in your main, and when your main is done, your application is done, so it will live long enough. Another one is QFile. QFile actually subclass QObject, and it does so it can emit signals, but often you are using QFile to open something, write or read whatever, and be done with. But QFile actually do inherit from QObject. it goes out of scope in the function where you're reading, so that's fine too. And then finally, we have top-level widgets like main window. I would often create my main window in my main, and then the scope is fine too. So this part here is just the Jesper, you said that, and that anything that inherits from QObject should be allocated using new. And here I have three examples where that is not true, and you are entirely right. Now, to the examples where it's very wrong to allocate using new, we have them down here. That are the value classes in Qt. They are the classes that are not supposed to go into an inheritance hierarchy. You're never going to subclass QString, QString list, or QColor. You're going to have an instance of a string represented by a QString class, and you might hand that around and so on, but it would be wrong to allocate it using new. Unless there are some objects in your system that hold the string for whatever purpose that is, and that that object, you're just basically referring to that other string's or that other object's string instance. But in your usual setup, when you create a string, just create an instance of a QString, and you can hand that around just as you please. QObject is a superclass for many of those things. And we've already talked about a few. We talked about QWidget, and QWidget definitely has a lot of subclasses, QPushButton, QTextEdit, QDialog, anything you see on the screen, in the Qt widget world at least, is a subclass of QWidget. But there's also subclasses of QObject that is not visible on the screen. And we have an example here, namely QFile. And let me just show you the help text for QFile, just to reiterate what we talked about in the previous episode here. I've got the documentation here. So here is a QFile class, and I can see all the public members, the re-implemented public functions, and so on. And there is nothing signal in here. So what were you talking about, Jesper, when you said signal slots? Well, QFile is not the final superclass of this. It inherits from QFile device, which inherits from QIO device. QIO device has a number of methods here, or a number of signals here for specifying whenever thing has been written. Would you use QFile in an synchronous mode? Well, likely not, but you definitely use QSocket, which is also a subclass of QFile, in an asynchronous mode, where it's useful to be notified whenever the bytes have been written. And back to the file hierarchy. That's where we'll start out in the next episode. We'll look at QWidget and see what the parent-child relationship means in the context of a QWidget. Until next time, have a great time. I'm Jesper Pedersen from QTopia, and I hope you enjoyed the training so far. There's definitely going to be much more episodes.